A very good afternoon to all the students. In this session, I'm going to discuss about a topic on S-MIME. So what S-MIME stands for is Secured Multipurpose Internet Mail Extension. So it is S stands for secure, and MIME is an acronym that is formed from multipurpose internet mail extension. So it is a security enhancement to the MIME internet email format that is already existing. So this particular S-MIME is going to provide the security with the help of the RSA data security. This one. Before this S-MIME, we have PGP, which stands for Pretty Good Privacy. Although both this PGP and S-MIME are defined under this IETF standards document, both of them are used for different purposes. For example, if you take S-MIME, this is going to be the industry standard for commercial and organizational units. So this S-MIME is going to be used by the organizations. Wherever you have some commercial organizations, they are going to use this S-MIME. Whereas if you consider this PGP is a good choice for the personal email security. So this PGP is used for personal emails, whereas the S-MIME is going to be used by different organizations to provide security for their email transactions. There is a difference between this PGP and S-MIME. So to understand this S-MIME, we need to have an understanding of the underlying email format. So what actually the format that is being used by the emails, that we should have an idea. And this underlying format of the emails is nothing but it is defined with the MIME. MIME stands for Multipurpose Internet Mail Extension. We know this one, right? So in order to understand this S-MIME, you should have a knowledge on this MIME. But to understand the significance of this MIME, again we should have a good idea on the traditional email format, which is a general email format, which is defined under this RFC 822. This RFC 822 is a very old email format, but it is still in use. And the most recent version of this RFC 822 is RFC 5322. Very important document, this one. So it specifies the internet message format. Or else you can also say that it specifies the internet mail format. So the point here you have to observe is, to understand S-MIME, you should have an idea on MIME. To understand MIME, you should have an idea on this traditional email formats, that is RFC 822 and RFC 5322. So this is all about the introduction part of the S-MIME. And let us have a look at this RFC 5322. What is this RFC 5322? As I told that, this is a traditional internet message format. And this RFC A5322 defines a format for text messages that we are going to transfer from one end to another end in the form of electronic mails. So this is going to deal only with the textual data. This is very important. So RFC 5322 is a very simple email format where it is going to deal only with the textual data, textual messages that we are going to send using this electronic mails. And it is a standard for internet based text mails. It is a standard for internet based text mails. And as I told that, this is still in use. That is the advantage we have this with this RFC 5322. So the main theme behind this RFC 5322 is the emails that we are going to send by making use of this RFC 5322 is going to have two parts. The first one is the envelope part, and the second one is the content part. So it almost appears like as if we are sending a normal post to your friend. So in the normal post also, whatever you want to write or whatever you want to convey to your friend, you will be writing it in on a paper, and you fold that paper. That is considered to be the content, the original data, what you want to convey to your friend. And that paper, you just fold it and you put it inside an envelope, and on the envelope you are going to write the destination address. So the envelope works as if it is the postman. That means it is going to deliver the content to your friend based on the destination address what you have written on this envelope. The same concept has been implemented in RFC 5322 also. As we have discussed that the envelope contains the information that is needed to transfer the mail content from one place to another place. So we can say it as the address part. And the contents consists of the original data which you want to deliver it to the recipient. And remember that this RFC 5322, it is going to be a standard that is being applied on the content only. So whatever rules you impose, that rules you are going to impose on the content only. This is one of the drawback we can say. However, the content standard includes a set of header fields. This is very important. So we are not going to put any restrictions on the envelope. RFC 5322 defines only the standards that are related to the content. But you never worry about whether it is going to provide any security or not. The thing is that it is going to specify the standards to the content, but this content includes a set of header fields that may be used by the mail system to create the envelope. So this content consists of some important data which is called as the header fields. These header fields work as the envelope. So you are indirectly specifying the RFC standards for the envelope also. So the overall structure of the message that conforms with the RFC 5322 is very simple. Very simple. A message consists of some number of header lines. We'll see with an example. So how does an RFC 5322 document look like? Means it consists of some header lines. which includes the destination address, subject, everything will be included, and it is followed by some textual data, only textual data. Why? Because we have discussed that RFC is confining itself to the textual data only. So this is called the header part of the RFC 5322, and this is called as the body of the mail, head and body. And how we are going to separate this header with the body is, the header and body are separated from each other by a blank line. We will see it with an example, don't worry. They are separated by a blank line. And the header, as we have discussed, that it consists of some keywords followed by colon, followed by some keywords again, and the format allows a long line to be broken up into several lines. So it also allows us to divide or to break the long line into small lines also. As we have discussed, that the common keywords that are used for these header lines is from and to, and we have subject, and you can also add date and some other fields also. When you are sending the mail, you must be very familiar with these particular keywords. So these are called the header of a given email. So here is the description what we have discussed till now. So RFC 5322 defines a format for text messages only that are being sent using the electronic mail. And this has been a standard for the internet-based text mail messages, and it is still in use. As I told that RFC 5322, the messages are divided into two parts, the envelope and the contents. The envelope contains the information that is needed to transmit or to deliver the content to the correct recipient. And the contents consists of the actual data which is to be delivered to the recipient. And RFC 5322 standard applies only to the contents, but as I told that the contents consists of the header fields, so you are indirectly applying the standards to the header fields also. And here is an example what we have here. If you look at this example, this one, it consists of two parts. The first part, this one, this is called the header part. And the second part, this is called as the body. In the terminology that is related to RFC 5322, you can say that this constitutes the contents and the header constitutes the header only. Or you can say that it is envelope. So if you look at the header part, as we told that it consists of different keywords ending with the colon, this one, here, here and here. And some of the keywords that we can use for this header format is the date, from, subject, to, and carbon copy, CC. And this one is the actual data that the sender wants to convey to the actual recipient. So the sender wants to send, hello, this section begins the actual message body, which is delimited from the message heading by a blank line. So you can observe here that the header part, this one, and the body part of the mail is separated by a blank line. This is blank line. And you can see that this particular header consists of different keywords. they can be written in the single line itself, nothing wrong in it. But in order to have proper understanding of what is written clearly, you can separate or you can break this entire line into several lines. So date is given one line, from is given one line, subject is given another line, to is given another line, and CC is given another line. But to separate the header and the body, or the envelope and the contents, you should give a blank line. So that gives the clear idea of what this RFC 5322 is. And once we are clear about this RFC 5322, that means the traditional email message format, let us see what we can do with this MIME. While discussing the concept of the RFC 5322, we have given an important point that RFC 5322 deals only with the textual data. But nowadays you have large extensions for the data. Many more extensions are there. It's not only the textual data you want to convey to your friend, or you want to convey to your world. You can send an audio file, or you can send a .exe file, you can send a video file. Like that, there are multiple extensions of files which you want to communicate with your friends. But if you go with this RFC 5322, it will not support the transfer of content with different extensions. That is the reason why we go with some advanced email formatting technique, which is called as the MIME. So the MIME is the acronym for Multi-Purpose Internet Mail Extensions. By this name, you can understand that it is going to support multiple extensions for the internet mail. So you can send the video files, you can send the pictures, you can send the audio files, anything you want to send, you can send it without any restrictions or without any barriers. So the multi-purpose internet mail extension is an extension to RFC 5322, which is intended or which is developed to address some of the problems or some of the limitations of this SMTP, which is defined under RFC 821. SMTP. In the last session, we have seen that this is an acronym for Simple Mail Transfer Protocol. So we have some limitations in this SMTP, which is defined under this RFC 821, and we have some limitations with this RFC 5322. Because of these limitations, or to overcome those limitations, scientists have come up with a new framework, which is called as the Multi-Purpose Internet Mail Extension. So before going to the original discussion on the MIME, let us see what are the limitations we have with this SMTP, or what are the limitations we have with this 5322. Here you can see that the SMTP cannot transmit executable files or other binary objects. Executable files will have an extension of .exe. Object files will have the extension of .obj. So the SMTP is not supporting to transfer this type of executable files or binary files. But one thing you can do with these executable files is, there are number of ways to convert these binary files into the textual format. But whatever transfer techniques that you are using to convert these exe or obj files into .txt files, they are not standard procedures. So when you don't use the standard procedures, you may end up with the problem of interoperability. So to cope up with the problem of the interoperability, you should always go with the standards documents or the standard protocols. That is very much important. And the second point is, SMTP cannot transmit textual data that includes national language characters. So every nation will have his own national language, which can be encoded with different codes. For example, national languages are represented by 8-bit codes. But the SMTP which you are going to use is going to make use of only 7-bit code. So when you want to transmit the national language code, for example, you want to transmit a mail with the German language. So the characters cannot be transmitted, the German characters cannot be transmitted over the mail if you are using the SMTP protocol. Why? Because it is not supporting the 8-bit codes. National languages are encoded with the 8-bit codes. SMTP supports only 7-bit code. So there is a mismatch in the coding technique. So they are not going to transmit the messages, national language messages. And coming to the third disadvantage or the third limitation, SMTP servers have the limited size for the mails. They have restrictions on the size of the mail. If you try to send a mail with more data, which is beyond the restricted size, the servers simply reject your mail. They won't transmit half part of the mail, and another part, half part, will not be transmitted in a sequence. All that they know is, whenever the size of the mail is greater than the threshold value of the mail size, it will simply reject that mail. So this is another limitation we have. And coming to the fourth point, the SMTP gateways that translate between the ASCII and character code EBCDIC do not use a consistent set of mappings, resulting in translation problems. So the same thing what we have discussed while we are transmitting the executable files or the binary objects. There are different things where you can convert the executable files into textual data, but as we told that we don't have the standard procedures for conversion of .exe files into .txt files. The same case exists with the gateways which are implemented to convert the ASCII characters into ABCDIC. These are different coding formats. ASCII, American Standards Code for Information Interchange. And there is another code which is called as EBCDIC. So when we are converting this ASCII to EBCDIC and EBCDIC to ASCII, there may be some translation problems when we go with these SMTP gateways. And similarly, the SMTP gateways to X400 electronic mail networks cannot handle non-textual data included in X.400 messages. Simply remember a point that SMTP always concentrates on the textual data. When you have textual data, then it will be okay. But when you have other formats of data, it will be very difficult to transfer those things using the SMTP. And similarly, the last limitation is the SMTP does not always adhere to the SMTP standards defined in RFC 821. So it may not follow the standards. So that is another disadvantage we have. To cope up with all these limitations of this SMTP, scientists has involved or scientists has implemented a new standard or a new framework which is called as MIME, and it is intended to resolve these problems, and it should be compatible with the existing RFC 5322 also, right? Whenever you implement a new thing, it should be compatible with the older versions. This is, you have to keep it in mind. When you develop a new version, that version should be compatible, backward compatibility. We call it as backward compatibility. So it should be able to have the compatibility with the old versions. That is called as backward compatibility. So the specification what we have with this MIME is specified in the RFC documents from 2045 through 2049. That means this MIME has been specified under this RFC 2045, 2046, 2047, 2048 and 2049. So five different documents are there to describe this MIME. So by this you came to know that the RFC document need not be restricted to a single document. As I told that RFC stands for recommended for comments. Anything you develop in the computer networks, you should expose it to the external world, and you should document it, and that is kept to the public, which is open to the public, and they can make their comments. That is what it is mean, recommended for comments. So there is no need that you always restrict yourself to with a single document. You can have multiple documents. For example, if you see this MIME, which is defined from RFC 2045 to 2049, five documents are there to specify the information related to the MIME. So once we are clear about these limitations of SMTP and why this MIME has introduced, let us see what this MIME specification includes. What are all the extra things that the MIME is having other than this SMTP? So that is called as the MIME specifications. The simple thing what you have to remember is the difference between SMTP and MIME is SMTP is going to support only textual data, whereas MIME is going to support multiple extensions. It can support the textual data, it can support the pictures, it can support audio files, it can support video files, like that it can support multiple formats. In order to support the multiple formats, it should have some extra information. That extra information we are going to discuss in this present discussion. So the MIME specification includes the following elements. So it consists of five new message header fields. So in addition to this RFC 5322 header, it consists of five new message fields, and these extra fields, message fields, provides the information about the body of the message. So it gives the extra information about the content of the message, whether the user is sending the textual data or whether he or she is sending the video data or the audio data, that information will be provided by these additional new message header fields. Similarly, it also consists of number of content formats. This is where the MIME differs with from the SMTP. So the number of content formats are defined. So these different content formats are used for standardizing the representations to support the multimedia electronic mail. So initially we don't have the mails that can transfer the multimedia content like audio and video. But with the invention of this MIME, we have the facility to make use of the electronic mail to transfer the multimedia content also. And coming to the third one, the MIME document RFC 2045-2049, this support different transfer encodings. So these transfer encodings are nothing but they are the techniques that are used to convert one content or one format of data into another format of data. Transfer encodings. So encoding is nothing but conversion of one format of data to another format. And they also provide some protection from alteration by the mail system. So you cannot alter the mails, that is, you cannot alter the original data. So that is all about this MIME. So these are all the additional fields or the additional things that we have in the MIME in addition to the SMTP or over the SMTP, additional fields over the SMTP, that will be the correct word. So let us see what are all these five message header fields we have. So the five header fields that are defined in the MIME are, the first one is the MIME version, the second one is the content type, and the third one is the content transfer encoding, and we have the content ID, and we have the content description. Very simple header fields. By looking at the terminology itself, you can simply understand what is this thing. So the MIME version specifies the value of the version of the MIME. So which version of MIME you are using, that is specified by the MIME version. In general, we have 1.0. So MIME 1.0. We'll see with an example. Then it will be very clear what is this MIME version and how we can represent it. So simply remember that the MIME version specifies the value of the version which the MIME is, which version of MIME you are going to use. And the content type specifies what data is contained in the body, what data is intended for the recipient, what data the sender is going to send, whether he is going to send a picture or a video file or an audio file, that information will be given under this content type. So it describes the data contained in the body with sufficient detail that the receiver user agent can pick up an appropriate agent. Why this is required means, at the receiving end, for example, if the sender is sending a video file and the content type is already having the information that the sender is sending the video file, so at the receiving end, when the receiver agent looks at the content type, they will come to an understanding that the sender has sent a video file. So whenever you click on that video file, it is going to open the correct software to run that program. So when you click on it, it will be automatically invoking the VLC media player or Windows media player, and it will play the content for you. So for that purpose, you require this content type. And the third header field is the content transfer encoding. This also we have discussed in the previous slide, that encoding is nothing but you are going to convert one format of data into another format, and you are going to protect your mail from the unwanted modifications. So it indicates the type of transformation that has been used to represent the body of the message in a way that is acceptable for mail transport. So the sender wants to send a message in some format, but here is the sender. Let me draw it. Here is the sender and this is the receiver. When sender wants to send a mail to the receiver, he is making use of one format, but the internet service provider is not accepting that format. So the content transfer encoding will convert the message from the sender's format to the internet format. And once the mail has reached over the internet to the receiver, here also the receiver is not in a position to understand what this internet format is. So here you require another encoding where you convert the internet format into the content or into the format that is understandable by the receiver. So that conversions or the transformations will be done by this content transfer encodings. And coming to the fourth point, which is content ID. It is used to identify the MIME entities uniquely in multiple contexts. The identification is everywhere it is same. For example, when we join our college, you will be given an ID card with one registration number. So that registration number can be used to identify you uniquely from a group of people. In the similar way, the MIME entities, we have multiple MIME entities and we need to pick a particular MIME entity uniquely. So that is done by making use of content ID. And the last one is the content description, where you have a text description of the object with the body. And this is useful when the object is not readable. So it just gives the description of what content the sender is sending. That's it. If you carefully observe the RFC 5322 header, these five header fields, what we have discussed now, the MIME header fields, maybe all or some of the fields may appear in a normal RFC 5322 header also. But the MIME version, the content type, content transfer encoding, content ID and content description fields are optional in the RFC 5322. Right? And they may be ignored by the recipient also. That's a different case. But these are the five different header fields we have. And once we are done with the different header fields, let us discuss a few important points regarding these MIME content types. As I told that the MIME has been introduced to make your email compatible for the transmission of multiple extensions of the mails, multiple extensions of the files. So you can send a MIME mail with the textual data where you have two categories, that is the plain and the enriched. Similarly, you can send a MIME message with a multi-part type where we have four different categories, mixed, parallel, alternative and digest. And similarly, you can send a message which is the RFC 822 partial and external body. We'll see each and everything, what actually is this external body, what actually is this RFC 822. and images. You can send the JPG file and GIF file. Video, you can send MPEG. Audio, the basic, and applications related to the PostScript, which is related to Adobe. And the Octet Stream, as the name itself is saying that it is going to deal with the 8-bit bytes. In general, RFC 5222 only deals with 7-bit byte data. But here we can make use of the 8-bit also, which we are going to make it with the application part. So these are all the different MIME content types we have. So the MIME specification is concerned with the definition of a variety of content types. This is what I have to discuss, right? And let us discuss what this textual data is. So for the text type of body, we don't have the requirement for any special software. And the primary subtype is the plain text. We have two subtypes. One is the plain text and the second one is the enriched text. So the plain text is nothing but the unformatted text. Simple plain text. Nothing more than. No format is there. And it can be an ASCII or it can be an ISO 8859 also. So it is a simple string of ASCII characters. That is what I am going to stress. So it is a simple string of ASCII characters. But when coming to this enriched textual content of MIME, here we are going to provide the greater formatting facilities. It is also a string of ASCII characters only, but they are going to involve in the more and more formatting flexibilities there. So that's all about this textual data. And coming to the multi-part data, which is very important. So the name itself is saying that the multi-part type indicates that the body contains multiple independent parts. That's why it is called as multi-part. Multiple independent parts will be there in the body. And the content type header field includes a parameter called a boundary that defines the delimiter between body parts. We'll see with an example. That means they will specify a line called boundary. And this boundary term defines the delimiter between the body parts. As I told that, multi-part means it consists of multiple parts in the body. Like this. And how we are going to separate these multiple parts means by making use of this boundary term. So this boundary should not appear in any part of the message. So internally you cannot write it as the boundary. Once you complete the one part of the body, you can make use of this boundary. Otherwise you cannot make use of it inside the body. I will tell you how we can write this boundary line also, right? It makes use of some two hyphens followed by the boundary value. That is the different case, I will tell you. And how we can identify the final boundary. The final boundary indicates the end of the last part. So in this particular body of the male, I have four parts. And at the end, you should specify the boundary also. And one more important point with this is, in this multi-part content type, within each part, there may be some additional MIME headers also. You can also include the additional MIME headers. And coming to the mixed data, let us discuss the subtypes. Let us discuss the subtypes of this multi-part content. The first one is the mixed data. So we can write it as multi-part hyphen mixed, where there are multiple independent body parts that need to be tied up into a single entity and in a particular order. Mixed, the name itself is having mixed. Therefore, there are different parts and they are independent but are to be transmitted together. So everything appears in a single mail, but they are different parts, but they are bundled and they are sent to the receiver. So at the receiving end, the receiver has to understand that entire thing is a single message. And similarly, if you go for this parallel part, the subtype parallel, multi-part parallel. So multi-part means it consists of different parts, but parallel means they differ from this mixed type, from they differ from the mixed only in that no order is defined for delivering the parts to be the receiver. So they are going to deliver the parts of the body in parallel. Therefore, there is no priority. So for example, let us take the same example. This is first part, second part, and third part, fourth part. So when it is mixed, then first the receiver has to get the first one, and then the second, and then the third, and then the fourth. This sequence has to be followed at the receiving end. But if it is parallel, everything goes in parallel. So the receiver can get the fourth one first, and then he or she can receive the second, third, first. Like that, anything can happen here. And coming to the alternative subtype, this is something very interesting. Here also we have different parts of the body of the message, and we have different parts that represent the same message, but they are expressed in different versions. So one here in this example, let us take the body is divided into four parts, 1, 2, 3, 4. 1, 2, 3, and 4, all of them represent the same content only, but they are expressed in different ways. They have different versions. And at the receiving end, the receiver's agent has to make the selection of the best version. So out of these four, which one is the best? That has to be presented to the receiver. So the best version of the different parts of the body has to be conveyed to the original recipient. And the last subtype, what we have here is the digest. So the multi-part digest is similar to the mixed, but the default type or subtype of each part of the message is RFC 822. That means the multi-part digest subtype is used when each of the body parts is interpreted as an RFC 5322 message with headers. So they have a restriction that all the parts of the body should be defined with RFC 5322 only. And the advantage of this subtype is it enables the construction of a message whose parts are individual messages. So as an example, what we can do is, for example, there exists a person who is called as the moderator here. We call him as a moderator. The purpose of this moderator, digest means it is going to take everything and it is going to output only single message. So let us take this entity which is called as a moderator. So we have a group of senders and recipients like this. The role of this moderator is he or she will collect all the messages from all the senders in the group. All the email messages are collected from the participants, and he or she will bundle these messages and send them out in one single my message. So that is what the digest is. So taking different emails and bundling it and then sending it as a single my message. So that is the purpose of this digest. And coming to the third one, MIME content types, the message type provides the number of important capabilities in MIME. For example, if you take this RFC 822 subtype, it indicates that the body is an entire message including header and body. So the body itself an encapsulated message that conforms to RFC 822. That means the body itself is having the contents as well as the header also. And coming to the second one, which is the message with partial subtype, it enables fragmentation of a large message into a number of parts. And at the receiving end, it is the responsibility of the receiver to reassemble at the destination. Reassemble all those fragments, partial, that means it is going to fragment, it is going to break down the large mail items into smaller pieces, and those smaller pieces are transmitted and the recipient will again reassemble them to form the large message. So that is the use of this partial. So whenever you divide a large mail into different smaller parts, you should have to keep track of those fragments. For example, you have taken a large message, you divided into three fragments. Let us say this is fragment 1, 2 and 3. So when you break this into three parts and you transmit it over the communication line, there may be a chance that three may be entered first, but the receiver will not take the three as the first part. Until unless he gets the first part, he won't combine these 1, 2 and 3. So in order to identify the fragments, in addition to whatever information it is having, it should also consist of additional information like the ID of each fragment. Similarly, the sequence number should be there. Sequence number to each and every fragment, and the total number of fragments has to be done. So these are the additional information, the ID, the sequence number of the fragments, and the total number of fragments has to be sent by the sender. Otherwise, it will be very difficult at the receiving end to combine them or to assemble them into a single entity. And the last one which we are going to discuss here is, this is also something interesting, the third sub-entity. The message external body, you can see here the term is external body. So as we know that the mail consists of the header and the body. In general, the body consists of the actual content which the user wants to transmit it from the sender to the receiver. This everything we know. But in the external body, the name itself is saying that the body is external. That means we don't have any actual contents in the body. But this body consists of pointers to an object that exists elsewhere. So my original content will be somewhere else. But the body of the email consists of pointers only. It does not consist of the actual contents. It consists of pointers which can be redirected to the actual contents. That is the reason why we call it as external body. The body is external. The actual contents are external. But what this Message consists of means the body of the message or the email consists of pointers to the objects that exist somewhere else. So we know what this image is. This is the JPEG file and this is the .gif file, and video we have MPEG format, and audio we have the basic format, which is defined as a single channel 8-bit ISDN with a sample rate of 8 kHz. And coming to the application type, it refers to different kinds of data. For example, if you take this Adobe PostScript format, or it may consist of interpreted binary data, or it may consist of uninterpreted binary data, or it may consist of information to be processed by mail based applications. And the octet stream, as I told that, generally binary data consists of 8-bit bytes. So these are all the various content types we have under this MIME framework. So let us see an example here. As I told that, MIME also follows the same RFC 5322 format only. That means it consists of the header and the body, which are separated by a blank line. So in the header, it consists of different keywords like from, to, and subject, ended with the colons. This everything we have discussed, right? And we have the blank line. And in the body, you can see that the first thing, the header field, the extra field what we have in this MIME is MIME version 1.0, and the content type is multi-part with a subtype of mixed. This is the type and this is subtype. So what is this multi-part mixed means? The content is described in multiple parts and they are mixed. So the order is important here. You should not interchange the order. And as we have discussed about this boundary, I want to separate each and every part with the boundary called simple boundary keyword. So this is one part of data. This is preamble. It is to be ignored, though it is a handy place. That is so and so. And this part one, and this is part two, this is part three, and this is part four. You can observe here that every part, part one and part two, are separated with simple boundary keyword. Preceded with double hyphen. Similarly, part 2 and part 3 are separated with simple boundary preceded with two hyphens. And the last one you can see here that whenever you want to convey that the next coming part is the last part, you have to use the keyword itself, but it should be preceded with two hyphens and also succeeded with two hyphens. So when you succeed anything, this boundary keyword with two hyphens, it is an indication that that is the last part of the message. Let us see another example with multi-part type and alternative subtype. So this is the header. You should have a blank line here. And the body is from here to here. You can see that the MIME version is 1.0 and the content type is multi-part alternative. And the boundary is defined with boundary 42. So the first one is the boundary 42. And this is one format, right? It is alternate. That means the same message you are going to convey it in different formats. So this is one format, this is another format, This is part 2 and this is part 1. So the same message, you are going to do it with the plain text with the character set US ASCII, and the same thing you are going to make use of the content type as enriched text, which have more formatting facilities. So at the receiving end, out of these two, the receiving agent has to select one best quantity and it has to be submitted or it has to be displayed to the end user. So once we have done with this MIME content type, let us have a discussion on the last topic under this MIME, which is the MIME transfer encodings. As we have discussed that the transfer encodings specify the transformation of one type of data to another type of data. So this is the another major component of the MIME specification in addition to the content type. And by definition, the transfer encodings are the transformations that are needed for the message bodies. The main objective of this transfer encoding is to provide the reliable delivery across the largest range of environments. So we have different environments, and in the each and every environment will make use of different formats. In order to make your message compatible, or in order to make your message deliverable to different environments which makes use of different formats, you should have a provision for transformation of one content type into another content type. So the MIME standard defines two methods for encoding data. There are two methods. We can call it as two encoding methods. And these are all the six values that the transfer encoding can take: the 7-bit, 8-bit, binary, X token, base 64, and coated printable. So these are the six types we have. But the first three, 7-bit, 8-bit, and binary, they indicate that no encoding has been done, but they provide some information about the nature of data. So this category, 7-bit, 8-bit, and binary. So one method is this 7-bit, 8-bit, and binary. These three are going to represent, or the three are going to indicate that no encoding has been done, but they are just provided to give some information about the nature of data. So for example, 7-bit, as we have discussed that SMTP makes use of this 7-bit transformation. And the 8-bit, natural languages or the national languages, they make use of the 8-bit encoding scheme. And the binary forms can be useful for the other mail transport contexts. So 7-bit is used for SMTP, 8-bit is used for the national languages, and the binary, it can be used for different contexts. And next one is these three. These three comes under another category. The first one, let us say X token. This X token indicates that some other encoding scheme is used for which a name is to be supplied. So X token, you can observe here that this is a non-standard encoding technique. This is not standardized. you are going to use some encoding scheme and you can name it with this X. For example, let us say that Raj, you can make use of some encoding scheme and you can put it as Raj token. U means you might be a vendor or it can be an application. So whenever you use a vendor, so whenever you have a vendor specific or application specific schemes or encoding schemes, you can make use of this X token and you can put your name. And the other two encoding schemes we have are the coated printable and the base64. So these two schemes are defined to provide a choice between a transfer technique that is human readable and one that is safe for all types of data in a way that is reasonably compact. So if you look at this coated printable, it encodes the data such that the data being encoded is mostly ASCII text. So whenever you say that it is ASCII text, it is easily understandable by the humans. So this encoding scheme is used for easy understanding of the humans. Whereas if you consider this base64 encoding scheme, it is also a very good encoding scheme, but it is going to encode the data and it is going to generate the base64 output. Right. So that is all about these base64 and coated printable. So this base64 can also be called as the radix64 also, another name we have. And this is all about the MIME transfer encodings. So in this session, we have gone through the discussion on the RFC 5322. We have seen examples of how this RFC 5322 messages will look like with the header part and the content part, and how we can separate the header part and the content with a blank line. And the restriction with this RFC 5322 is we have a lot of restrictions. The primary is we can transmit only textual data. In order to transmit more extensions of files, you require some other framework which we have defined it under MIME. So while discussing the concept of MIME, we have gone through the limitations of SMTP or the 5322, and then we have seen the specifications of the MIME. Like it includes 5 new headers, it includes new content formats, it includes transfer encodings, and everything we have discussed. And we have seen the 5 header fields like MIME version, content type, content transfer encoding, content ID and content description. And after that we have gone through the MIME content types, where we have 7 types, and again we have subtypes like text is having subtype of plain and enriched, multipart is having a subtype of mixed, parallel, alternative and digest. Like that we have seen each and every point regarding this MIME types. And finally we have seen these examples on this MIME also, and finally we have ended up our discussion by a discussion on the MIME transfer encodings. We have 6 different encodings: 7-bit, 8-bit, binary, X token, base64 and coated printable. So that gives the clear idea of how the RFC 5322 looks like and how the MIME looks like. So that's all for today's session. Thank you one and all for joining the session. And in the next session we are going to discuss about the SMIME. So, secured multipurpose internet mail extension. Thank you one and all.